Well, let's pay for the offering with quickly. Father, Lord, thank you so much for the offerings, Lord. We pray. Once again, we present this to you, to your feet. We use it continuously for your glory and for your kingdom. And thank you so much for your love and how much you love Crossover. And may we always continue to show that love back to you. We love and we thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, thank you all for coming to our, I guess, what we call this, like the fourth annual. I don't know. But I guess I probably chose the worst place to stand to preach. But I did it on purpose because I'm thinking to myself, if I stand right here, you're probably not going to pay attention because you're going to look at the beautiful scenery behind me. But I chose that for a reason. Because I want you, you know, to soak in. And I don't want you just to listen to what I'm trying to say, what I have for you. What I want you to do is I just want you to look and just to feel the breeze and feel and just to see the beautifulness of this place. And this is a testimony. I think God did this for a reason. I think everything happens for a reason. I just kind of share with you. I came here just to go back to our regular shelter that we always go at up here. And then I went there there's already a church there praising and cooking the food and they're about to do their service, and immediately my face was like, oh my goodness, are you kidding me? And I was like, I started to feel kind of like anxious, bitter, not bitter, but anxious and angry at the same time, because I'm human, you know, so I'm like, what is going on here? Do these people come here without reserving? Because I reserved this way ahead of time. It's something I don't usually do, but I reserved it way ahead of time, and I'm like, what is going on here? And I get up there, and I guess it was the pastor or the youth pastor there. I was like, I think we were supposed to have this place, and he's like, no, we reserved this place. And I'm like, I have an email here too, and he's like, I have an email too. I'm like, okay, how can I win? So he was like, they told me that there was going to be another church, and they overbooked this place. And I was like, well, when did you reserve it? They said, we did it like way ahead of time. And I'm thinking to myself, dang it, I did too. And I was like, I was like, okay, what can we do? And the guy said, we should go down here and talk to the ranger. I said, okay. So I went down to the ranger, and the ranger said to me, we apologize. There was a computer glitch. And somehow the computer started overbooking a lot of people. And he goes, but we do have a place for you if you choose to use it. And I didn't know about this place. I just know about that place. And she said, the person was like, would you like to come and see it? And I said, sure, why not? So they brought me here, and I was like, wow, this is totally an upgrade. This is an upgrade. And just for the price of this place, it's a couple $100 just to reserve. The place over there, it's under $100. So you can see that God gave us an upgrade to soak in. And the beautifulness of the decoration and the whole planning of this picnic is Liza. Thank you so much. So it's good. It's good that we are, you know, are having a lot of us kind of step in and do a lot of things. Because you guys know that if I was planning, none of this would be on here. Let's just eat and go. I just wanted to kind of share you just real quickly. As I mentioned, as we just kind of gaze at God's creation, I mean, just kind of look around, just like the beautiful, like the leaves are all falling, changing colors, and the water, and just the calmness of this place. You know, truly, when we look at out and look at all this thing right now, as you kind of just meditate, everything in this world, I believe, is a sermon. Everything here that we see and we encounter and we experience is a sermon about His glory, His power, and His majesty. You know, He's great. He's almighty. He's an amazing God. And I think He allowed us to witness and have this place so that we can truly uplift His name and give Him all the glory. And whatever you guys are going through this week or have been going through, you know, put all those things to the side and just concentrate on our Heavenly Father, and our Heavenly God, and our Savior. You know, so I was thinking about picnic, and I was thinking, what can I share? Something that's really short. I remember going to King's Dominion last month, and I was telling this last, but I have a slight fear of heights. All right, whenever I'm like really high up in the air, for some reason my lower half of my body tingles. You know, it just kind of tingles, and I can function. I'm not like crazy, like, oh, you know, I'm not that. I can, but I just don't like it. And in Kings Dominion, they have the fly, the carousel that goes up and it swings. You know what? I forgot what that was called.
Wind Seeker.
And it goes like 100, it's like 300 feet up, and it just twirls around. And all my family members, let's go. And I said, nah. I'll just sit here. You guys go ahead. And so I was sitting there, and I was waiting for them. It was kind of hot, and I was eating some kind of Korean chips or something. And it fell. And as minute it fell, I noticed underneath me, there was this hordes of ants. A lot of ants. I mean, those crazy ants. And I remember just sitting there, I was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I was sitting here with all these ants. But then I began to just examine them. I began to just to study them and watch them and look at them. And I was just looking how amazing they were working to get this little chip to where they were supposed to go. At first, all these ants would just come in, and they would cover the ant, they would cover the chip. And all of a sudden, you see little movements, like this one ant will go underneath it and other ants will go on top of it, and you'll see them working, and they'll kind of move this chip little by little. And I'm thinking to myself, where are they going? Because it's like, man, it's so big. But they're moving somewhere, right? I didn't stay long enough to see where they went, right? Because I'm not gonna spend my whole day looking at an ant. Alright, so but there's just a little glimpse that I had. I was watching and I was amazed. You know, I think God likes to use a lot of things of his creation to teach us a lesson. If you look at the Bible, there's so many instances where God uses an animal to teach a human. We saw the instance of the donkey, and we see that God uses an ox. And today, where I want you to talk about, did you know that the Bible also talks about an ant? In Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6, get my Bible here. It says here, Proverbs 6, chapter 6, it says, go to the ant, O you sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. All right? Go to the ant, you sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. And I think what Solomon was trying to say in his Proverbs and what God is speaking to Solomon is that there's some things that we can learn from an ant. All right? Some things that we can take away and understanding the ant. Did you know that there are 11,000 different kinds of ants in this world? There's 11,000 different kinds of ants. There are as many as one colony, about 20 million ants. Right? 20 million ants in like one colony. Alright? I don't know who finds this out, but I don't know the statistics. I don't know how they get this number. But they said that there are approximately 1 quadrillion ants in the world. Right? I don't know how they find that out. I don't know. But there's 1 quadrillion ants in the world. They said that scientists believe that if you get the whole ant in the Amazon, at the Amazon, if you just piled up all the ants, they will weigh more than all the animals combined in the Amazon. If you take all the ants that were living in the Amazon. All right, definitely, you know, something to kind of be awed at and inspired by it. Like, wow, this is crazy. But God uses the ants in Proverbs to teach us something. I just want to share that with you. I think the first thing that we can learn from an ant and the ant colony is that when you look at an ant, and what I saw there is that they work with unison. They work in a partnership. You don't see an ant hating on someone. You don't see an ant doing their own thing. You see, they work in love. When you see them, they're working in love. They're working together. And I think for the last several weeks, I've been talking about in 1 John, the importance of brotherly love, the importance of loving one another, the importance of, in a church, to look out for one another, to be there for one another, to pray for one another. It's very important, it's very vital that we understand this, that when we look at the ant, they're working in love. And that's what I believe as a church, what God wants us to do as a church, is also to continue to work in love. They are very helpful to one another. They help each other's burdens. Like I said, I saw one ant go underneath the chip and another one on top. And And they're working around. They're helping each other. And they're carrying their burdens for one another. You see, in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, it says, bear one another's burden, so to fulfill the law of Christ. Right? Paul tells us that we are to bear each other's burdens. What does that mean, bear each other's burdens? Isn't that when a sister or brother is in need, we are there to help. We are there to pray for them. Now, we have to be careful, though. And this is, I say this very, very strongly, that we have to be careful between a male helping a female. Alright? We gotta be careful, and we can kind of say, hey, you're doing okay, things like that, but no more. I think when a female is really struggling, when a female is really in burden and they need someone to talk to, that's when you refer them to Sister Una. Right? Or another person that you know in the church that is maybe godly and someone that can mentor. Because we need each other, females, to work with each other, and males with males each other, and kind of work in that, share that burden together. Because lots of times what happens is, and I see it, I mean, this world is crazy. I just read an article, I don't know if you read this article or not, but there was this pastor in Alabama. Did you read that? There was this pastor in Alabama, after 20 years of serving at a church, a couple Sundays ago, he finally confessed. He said that God told him to confess. So he confesses, saying, I'm sorry, church. I've slept with numerous of women in our church. Right? He comes out, and everybody's like, oh, shocked. What's going on? But the kicker was, I'm sorry to those that I slept with. I have AIDS.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, it was bad. Look at an article, Alabama pastor. Right? And not only that, he was saying that, I'm sorry, I took the church money and did this and all. And then the crazy thing was that there were like, when you're in debt, when you're involved with such heresy and craziness, the people's eyes get blinded. Like half of the church still wanted that church, that pastor to be there. And the half were like, are you crazy? And it's a mess. But see, what happens is that Satan is the what do you call it? Satan is the one that I believe is the one that brings everything into that light. His goal is to break up churches. His goal is to make churches divide. His goal is to make no church in America or anywhere in this world to survive, to be successful. So he'll do everything he can to dismantle that. So that means he'll come and he'll talk to someone like, you know, unconsciously about, hey, hate this brother, or hey, hate this sister. Or he'll continue to come and he'll try to up, like, oh man, and bring complaints to the church. Oh man, that praise band, that was nasty, that was so terrible. Oh, that you know, that pastor David, man, I hope he's losing some weight. I'm just joking. But, you know, just keep on instilling all these different things into your hearts, into your minds, to disrupt the church. And that is why it's so important for us to understand that as a church, if we're going to call ourselves Crossover Church, we're going to call ourselves a body of Christ, we have to love each other. We have to. We got to let down any of those things that are bitterness, whatever, and we got to be there just for one another. We're a family. You know, it doesn't matter what I've done or what I will continue to do. I'm a sinner. We're going to sin. But then we got to still accept one another and forgive one another. And at the same time, we got to discipline as well. But that's no discipline that we should be able to hand out by totally destroying that person. Romans 15:1 says, We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. You see, Paul says it right here again. Those who are mature in our walk with Christ, that's our obligation. That is our calling. That we are to help those that are weak, those that are failing, those that are having a hard time in their walks in their Christian life. We are those who know the Bible and have studied the Bible and maybe are more walking consistently in our walk with Christ. We got to be there for our brothers and sisters. Just like how the ants are. When you look at the ant, they operate in harmony. Right? They operate in harmony. This is what the Bible says, and we talked about this before. Like the body is the church is the one body of Christ. You know, all of us are the body of Christ. We're all connected to Christ, right? We might be a hand here, we might be a feet there, but whatever, we're all still one body, and we all have this one thing that we're pursuing, and that is to glorify God. Did you know there's a certain ant in Africa called the driver ants? When they get together, When they're on their prowl, when they are on their journey together as an ant, they said that lions, elephants, poisonous snakes, and even entire village of people move out of the way. They just don't want to deal with them. All right? You see how powerful it is when one church in unison get together by the Holy Spirit, togetherness. That's how the early church started. The early church, when Peter came and he, you know, preached at the Pentecost, 3,000 members got saved. Do you think those 3,000 members who got saved just walked along by themselves? They stuck together, and guess what happened the very following next day? 5,000 people came to know the Lord. What happened after that? 10,000. And it kept multiplying, because of the powerful movement of one church, one colony, one in harmony. It says here in Philippians 1:27, it says, "Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am I absent, I might hear of you that you're standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side by the faith of the gospel." Paul says it, that when I come back, I'm hoping to hear that you guys are all in one spirit, one mind, striving side by side by the faith of the gospel. You see, we have to walk side by side. That's crossover. Yeah, there might be a church down the road. Yeah, there's other churches down there, and they're all, I'm not saying they're bad, they're all, you know, have their things, but we as crossover, if you come in here, and if you're joining part of our church, we're one family, and that's what the mentality I want us to have, is that we're one family, that we can move on together, and let us be like those driving ants, that let us just drive forth and go forth, and everything that steps in our way, Satan, obstacles, craziness, things might happen, boom, no problem. Why? Because we got each other and we got God. Another thing about the ant that we should learn is that ants, when they work, they have installed them a voluntary nature. Meaning, there's no guide. There's no one to teach them. There's no one to say, hey, do this. There's no one to say, okay. They all just go and do it. They see a need and they do it. You see, I think a lot of times, and I think a lot of us might have questions about our church, and I want to just kind of come out with you and say this, is that we don't have leaders here. We're called servants, right? For a while, for our church, this is our third year going on as a church, and I felt like that when we have a leader position, the title becomes too prideful. And I felt like instead of us setting these leaders at right now, because the state of our church is still small. But right now, if all of us can just jump in the boat, jump in the boat and work together and serve. You don't have to be called a leader to serve. If Christ is calling you to do something, do it. Serve. If you feel like, oh, my heart is not in the right place, but I still want to serve. If you're a believer, if you really want to serve God, my nature is that, man, if you want to serve, just do it. Because when you do, you're going to grow. Right? When Christ came to his disciples, he didn't look at his disciples and said, all right, drop your nets, go for 1 year, go fast, go pray, and do all these different things, and then you can follow me. He didn't say that. He said, drop your nets and just come follow me. Why was Jesus saying that? Because he knew that through his life, they will be trained. That watching and seeing Jesus do things, it would change their life. And that's what I really believe. I said, I believe that anybody here has the ability to be servants in this church. Serve in the ways you can. You see, that's why, you know, when you look at the ants, all these ants serve in their own ability. Right? They all have different abilities. Did you know that each ant has something about them that is special to them? Right? The same thing. God has given you all different types of gifts. We can look around here and we can kind of go down, and I can kind of say, what's your gift? I'll guarantee you a lot of us will have different gifts. And those are the things that whatever God's given you, those gifts, use it to his glory and serve at the church. Did you know there's a certain type of ant called a honeypot ant? The honeypot ant is an ant that will go out and eat a lot of the nectars. Right, and it will store up nectars in its body so that when he comes back to the colony, it will be able to feed others. Now, I don't know if that means that he's given his life and they all eat him up. I don't know if that's the case. But somehow I think he was able to just be able to provide their needs. You see, there's everybody here has a gift that they can give to the church. And sometimes we're just so blocked by, I don't know what the word is, but we're so blocked by procedures and different things that we are afraid to serve. Just serve. Come to me and say, hey, Pastor David, this is something that's on my mind. I'm going to be like, go for it. If it's biblical. If you can't just come to me and say, I decided that I want to be a Bible study teacher at a, stripper club. I'm going to say no. I'm going to say no. There's some guidelines. But if there's something that you want, come tell me. And if it's biblical, I'm going to say, yeah, go for it. Do it. And that's what I'm hoping that our church can be, especially at this stage we are in. You know, I feel like we're kind of growing, and then this is where it's important. This is where all of us need to be in the same page to get over this hump. Because this happens a lot with churches. They get to a certain plateau, they get to a certain point. And if everybody's doing their own thing and everybody doesn't, want to give their all to the church or to God, it'll just drop again. If you want to see our church succeed and be a different force in the community, you got to take ownership of the church. You got to take ownership. Meaning, no longer are you just saying, oh, I'm coming to PD's church. Or I'm coming because of this. You come to church because it's your church. You come to this church because this is where you see your God. This is your church because this is where you can see God moving and working. You see, this is the mentality I feel like, and I hope that all of us can come when we come to Crossover. Is that you're coming to Crossover not because of the name, but because of what God can use you through in this church and the gifts that he's given you. You see, 2 Peter 3:18 says, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and now to the day of eternity. That's what we're here to do. We're constantly going to continue to grow. We're going to learn. We're going to learn from each other. And that's why we need to be accountable and continue to be there for one another. And finally, last thing is this. When you look at an ant, they're always working continuously. They don't stop. And not only that, is that they work all day without any type of recognition or encouragement. There's nobody there to pat it on his back, saying, good job. There's nobody there to reward them. There's nobody there to say, good job, you're doing great, keep pushing on. The ants just work, and they do it. You see, I think that's somehow for us who are serving or want to serve. I know the importance of saying encouraging words, but sometimes, people who don't get encouraged, there's people that are in the back behind scenes that are just as important as those that are up in the front. Does that make sense? We need a lot of those people too. And if you really desire encouragement words, come to me. I'll give you plenty. All right, I'll give you plenty. That's my love language, is encouraging word. I can go about a whole week and 2 weeks if Sister Anna doesn't say anything to me, I get kind of down. I'm like, when Sister comes to me and says, I love you, I'm like, and then boom, that little one word I can last for a week or so. I'm filled up. But so if you want some encouraging words, hey, I'll give you some, and I know, God will give you some. But the whole idea is that, what God is saying in Proverbs chapter 6, that for all of us, don't be lazy. Don't be lazy in the work that you're called to do, especially in your Christian life. Don't be lazy with your Christian life. Work at it. Do it in love and harmony and unity, forgiving each other, loving each other, using your gifts, serving without expecting much, but just give and give. And I guarantee you that we'll be able to move on and become what God wants us to be in our church. And that's amazing. If you ever see, ants don't build like huge structures of building, but they can build an anthill, which is amazing. As I looked at the ants at King's Dominion, and as I was walking away, I know I stepped on a few of them. but I just walked away saying, wow, I wonder how much that is with God when he looks at us. Don't you think God looks at us like little ants walking around? I feel so powerful just sitting up and just looking at them. And you know what the funny thing is? Like sometimes I want to kind of help them. I kind of wanted them to push that chip a little further for them. You know, and I had the power to do so. But I knew that if I did, that I wonder if they will really learn something from it. And I see, I think that's a lot of us too. I think God is there. And sometimes he's just kind of looking and saying, you can do this, you can do this. Because he wants you to grow and he wants you to learn as well. And when you accomplish that, what you're going through, it's going to feel that much more joyful, much more peaceful. So learn from the ants and learn from what they do. And we can use that scenario in our own church. So let's take time to pray.